Family, y'all. Just keep it tight, keep it tight, keep it tight. All right. Yeah. Here we go.
The great Cappadocians. When we talk about the Cappadocians, we typically think of Basil of Caesarea, St. Basil the Great. We think of St. Gregory of Nyssa, who is his younger brother. And we think of St. Gregory of Nazianzus. So when we think of the Cappadocian fathers, typically it's those three, great fathers of the Eastern Church. But what's interesting is that Jose Justo González, now that he wrote his updated version, which is more friendly to women, he said in his introduction, what does he do? He also includes their sister, Basil and Gregory of Nyssa's sister, whose name was Macrina. How interesting. I kind of like his rewriting of history in this next edition, only because when I was in the seminary, we didn't have the stories of Macrina, but how it is that she influenced her brother Basil. So Macrina then told Basil that he was becoming vain with wisdom. He's going off and learning all sorts of things and coming back and saying, oh, I know things that you don't know. And Macrina, who's holier than him, says, you know, I'm just not sure that you're the brother I used to know and love. You're becoming vain. They had another brother, Naucratius. Naucratius was not like Basil. Basil was all vain. Naucratius more simple and humble. Naucratius now dies, and that was a moment that changed Basil's life. You know, when someone close to you dies, it makes you start thinking of things like, you know, one day I'm going to die too. How do I want to be remembered? Do I want to be remembered by my sister as being some vain, pompous, fill in the blank, right? Is that how I want to be remembered? And so as a result then, Dr. González tells us how it is that Macrina taught Basil the principles of the desert ascetics. All these people who were running out in the desert, what are some of the things that they all had in common? People like Athanasius and those who were actually living out in the desert. Most of them, for instance, were less interested in gold and honor and glory, and they were more focused on their relationship with God, their spiritual life. What are some of those principles that she taught him? True happiness is found in serving God, not in the glories of the world. Which was Basil more interested in previously? The glories of the world. Is that where true happiness is going to come? No. Service is best rendered when one breaks all ties with the world. We talked about that last time. Fuga mundit was what they were saying back then, right? To flee the world. You really want to grow closer to God? You're going to be able to do it in the middle of Austin with all of its action and busyness? Better for you to go out in the middle of the hill country to flee the world. Break the ties from the world and from your family and all these other cares and concerns. Leave yourself, your iPhone, or your BlackBerry behind. Right? Dress and food must be as simple as possible. Should we... I mean, if you're living out in the desert, you don't have to worry about the food part too much, I'm imagining, right? Dress, you know, you don't have to worry about getting all dressed up, and you don't have to worry about wearing a tuxedo in the middle of a desert. Devoting yourself entirely to prayer, you know, it was just, what did those ascetics do out in the middle of the desert? They prayed. What else can you do out in the middle of the desert? Not great cell phone reception out there. Right? Not a lot of electrical outlets that you can plug your television into. They focused on their relationship with God. Prayer. So, Macrina, because she influenced her brother in that way, because he later went off to become the person he became, she was known as the teacher, but González suggests that she might rightly be called the founder of Greek monasticism, because can you imagine, had it not been for older sister telling her brother, you are so pompous and vain. You know, would he have turned out the same way? Basil the Great, or Basil of Caesarea. Remember that Caesarea was that city on the coast built in honor of the Caesar. After studying the monastic life, then, he and his friend Gregory of Nazianzus founded a community for men, similar to Macrina's community for women. So how interesting. She led the community for women, was an abbess of sorts. They led the community of men, were the abbots of sorts of their community. He's typically regarded as the father of Eastern monasticism. After 6 years as a monk, he was ordained a presbyter against his will. Listen for that theme this evening about people doing things against their will. Being ordained a presbyter or priest against his will. And then he had difficulties with his bishop. So difficulties with bishops are certainly nothing new in the history of the church. And he returned to monastic life. He went to Caesarea to help a bishop in his struggle against Arianism. And Dr. Gonzalez shares the name of that bishop, which we didn't capture here. But he went to Caesarea to help a bishop in his struggle against Arianism. And it's interesting because he wrote, now that he's no longer a monk out in the middle of the desert, he's seeing the various things that are happening in Caesarea. For instance, that in Caesarea, the crops were destroyed that year. So when the crops are destroyed, that's less food. What does that mean for us then? It means that there may be some people without food. The rich are fortunate because they can go down to the supermarket and stock up on canned goods. Can the poor do the same? No. So I put here the entire quote by St. Basil the Great. He wrote, "If one who takes the clothing off another is called a thief," right? If you steal someone's clothes, you're called a thief. "Why give any other name to one who can clothe the naked and refuses to do so?" If in my closet I have clothes to be able to clothe that person on that street who doesn't have anything, and I refuse to do it, then I'm a thief, Basil is saying. "The bread that you withhold belongs to the poor." All that food that you have at home in your pantry, who does it belong to? To the poor. Ooh. "The cape that you hide in your chest belongs to whom? To the naked. The shoes rotting in your house belong to those who must go unshod." Ooh, this is a serious condemnation. It makes us all think of our own closets, right? And that pair of shoes that I haven't worn in 2 years, how it is that someone else could be wearing those shoes. Basically, is even stronger, saying, no, it's not that someone else could be wearing those shoes. Those shoes belong to the poor. And if you're not giving, sharing them with the poor, then you are a thief. Interesting, the view toward the poor and those in need, right? If you have something that you can be sharing with someone else and they're going without, then you are a thief if you refuse to share it. With Gregory of Nazianzus, then, he created a new city outside of Caesarea. So imagine for a moment going outside the city and creating your own place then where you can feed the hungry and care for the ill and give employment to the unemployed. Essentially, go to all your wealthy friends and say, hey, would you like to help secure your place in heaven one day? I need food, I need clothing, I need things to share with those in need. When the Bishop of Caesarea died, Basil, who had done all this good work, was elected by the people to be the next Bishop of Caesarea. Remember back then that the bishop was elected by the people and then was consecrated by other bishops who believed the same thing. Now the emperor, now that we have a new bishop in Caesarea, the emperor is coming to Caesarea. Is the emperor now a friend of Orthodox Christianity, or is the emperor a friend of Arianism? The emperor is a friend of Arianism now. The pendulum has swung. So now what's happening is the emperor is getting ready to come to your city. You're an Orthodox Christian. You know that he's going to come saying what he said to every other bishop of the towns that he's visited. Namely, wouldn't it be nice if you were Arian too and were singing the Donald Duck song with all the rest of us? So they sent a delegation ahead to prepare for the emperor's visit, threatening Basil, you know, trying to cajole him so that he's saying the right things when the emperor comes. And Basil tells them, all that I have that you can confiscate are these rags and a few books. That's all I own. Nor can you exile me, for wherever you send me, I shall be God's guest. You know what? You can send me out of the city, but you know, I don't want to be in exile. God will be with me no matter where I am. As to torture, you should know that my body is already dead in Christ. Go ahead and torture me. You know what? My body's already dead. And death, if you're thinking about killing me, Go for it. Death would be a great boon to me, leading me sooner to God. What do you do with a person like this? Right? If you torture them, they're happy with that. If you kill them, they're happy with that. If you take away anything, there's nothing that you can do to punish this person. So when the prefect said that no one had ever spoken to him like that, I mean, usually when the prefect speaks, you do what he or she says. When the prefect says, no one has ever spoken to me like that, Basil responded by saying, perhaps that's because you never met a true bishop. During this era when all the bishops were interested in climbing up this hierarchy and resembling more like what we saw in civil society, all the pomp, all the riches, all the honors and title, Basil was giving a very different witness, a different example. So Basil, definitely an example of a person whose spirit was not easily broken, or a person who was not easily intimidated. He's remembered for organizing and spreading monastic life and for advancing the Nicene Creed. So we have Basil to thank for being one of those staunch defenders again of orthodoxy, or what we consider to be orthodoxy at the time, how it is that Jesus is of one being or of one substance with the Father. So that was the first of the male Cappadocians, Basil the Great. His younger brother was Gregory of Nyssa. Gregory then was his quieter younger brother. After Gregory's wife died, he joined monastic life. Everyone else in the family is doing it, right? Between Basil and Macrina. I tried marriage, didn't work out so well. You know, why don't we join monastic life? After that, how interesting that he championed celibacy and virginity, having known both lives. He saw the monastic life as a mean of avoiding many of the pains and struggles in life. Saying to himself, you know what? All of these women, we love them who gave us birth, but they could have avoided a lot of pain in life by being celibate, being virgins. So why don't we all just go out in the desert?
He wouldn't have been born.
But how interesting that from it's at this time that we're seeing this new value coming up in the church of how it is that there are certain people who are saying, ooh, it's better to be celibate than to be doing other things. How interesting that it's people like Gregory, whose voice has become influential in later centuries, where then people look back and start justifying things like a celibate priesthood in the Roman Catholic Church with the likes of Gregory of Nyssa. How much better it is. Gregory would know, he was married, right? So Gregory of Nyssa, that's Gregory of Nyssa. The other Gregory of Nacianzus then, was actually a friend of Basil. So Basil knew these two Gregories. One was his younger brother Gregory, the other was his friend Gregory. Gregory was the son of the bishop of Nacianzus. Ooh, we've heard that a few times throughout this course. The son of a bishop. You son of a bishop. What? Back then, we recognize how it was. Did I miss something? Recognize how it was that many bishops and elders and deacons, they were married. So to be called the son of a bishop was not such an uncommon thing. So Gregory was the son of a bishop. He studied 14 years in Athens. After that, he went home to Nacianzus then and joined Basil in living monastic life. So here's an educated man who spent some time in Athens studying philosophy, being in that culture, now coming back and joining the monastery. He was ordained an elder, a presbyter, how? Against his will. How interesting that all these people who go out into the desert and become monks, is their interest to become ordained, enjoy certain powers and privileges and rights? They just want to be in the desert with God. They just want to pray, right? So he was ordained against his will, then returned to Basil's community. After Basil became the bishop of Caesarea, he named Gregory a bishop. Did Gregory want to be a bishop? Did he even ask Gregory? Hey, I'm thinking about naming you a bishop. Instead, he named Gregory bishop of a small hamlet, and that strained their relationship. The story is told that they died not talking to one another, right? You did what? You're naming me a bishop? Yeah, that was not part of his plan. When Basil died, then Gregory took a leading role against Arianism. The people of Constantinople elected him bishop and patriarch, which simply means that when the emperor later convened the Second Ecumenical Council, brought together all of the bishops of the church, who was in his new capital, which was Constantinople. Ooh, look at that. Before we had four patriarchs in Alexandria, Jerusalem, Antioch, and Rome. Now that the capital, that we have a capital in the east, at the intersection of Asia and Europe and Africa, how interesting that now that we have this, we're getting together all the bishops of the church in 381. Who is the bishop or the patriarch of Constantinople? That would be our friend Gregory. And what does that mean for Gregory then? Gregory is the host at this council. Gregory presided over the council then in 381, where we're going to declare then the divinity of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. So our Trinitarian theology is going to date back to 381, this Council of Constantinople. It reaffirmed Nicaea, clarifying the difference between ousia and hypostasis. Hypostasis, we translated as persona in Latin, essentially giving us how it is that they're all of one being, one essence, but there are three persons. Have you heard that language before? One God, three persons, Council of Constantinople. Interesting, because now the Latin-speaking West and the Greek-speaking East agreed on a common formula. One God, three persons. One ousia, one essence, one being, but with three different hypostases, or three different persons. God the Father is God. God the Son is God. God the Holy Spirit is God. One God, three persons. That's the Council of Constantinople. The Arian position, with the Arians, so the Arians, remember that the Arians said that Jesus was created, right? So it's interesting that the Arian position was preferred by those in power, because those in power had this view of a strong, mighty God sitting on a throne somewhere, okay? So that God then created other beings like Jesus. If you're in power, wouldn't you prefer that kind of a God? What kind of a God do you prefer if you're in power? The kind of God who sits on a throne like you? Or the kind of God who becomes flesh and is a crucified criminal dying on a cross? If you're the emperor, which vision of God do you prefer? I'm guessing the God on the throne. You don't want to be planting the idea in anyone's mind that God was a carpenter, just like the carpenter down the street. God was like that. And died as a crucified criminal. As a crucified criminal, are you listening to yourselves? Right? That's not the view that the emperor wants, because then anyone, Mario, the bilingual counselor at an elementary school, begins thinking that if God became a carpenter, God was one of us. Ooh, you follow me? The emperor had a god that the emperor could identify with, which was this god of Arius, a god who sits on the throne and creates everything else in the world. The god of the people is this crucified criminal who is a carpenter, a person like us. So what balance are we going to strike after this council? How interesting that the Arian position was that God is not a carpenter crucified as a criminal, but is more like the emperor on the throne. That's the Arian position. The compromise was that the carpenter, Jesus, was declared truly divine, God. Jesus the carpenter is God. But what are the pictures that we're going to see of Jesus from this point forward? Of him as the Pentocrator. Have we heard of the Pentocrator? The Pentocrator are all these paintings of Jesus where Jesus is having a big crown, like the emperor, sitting on a throne, like the emperor, ruling over heaven and earth, like the emperor. How interesting. No pictures of any weak human being. No, Jesus is now Lord of the universe, God of the universe. Pentocrator is a Greek word meaning almighty or all-powerful, which is essentially the image that we have of Jesus when Jesus is dressed as a king on a throne. Jesus is the all-powerful. And so, for instance, if we were to go to the National Cathedral, you know, what's going to happen in history is we're going to get all sorts of other images of Jesus, right, where Jesus is ruling over as Lord of the universe. How it is that it's this image of this strong, all-powerful, almighty Christ.
Well, in the Orthodox Church, they always have seen him cheer, but he doesn't look happy.
Say that again?
In the Orthodox Church, I've seen pictures of Jesus sitting in the throne.
He doesn't look happy. So how interesting that this is going to change our theology now, because suddenly if we're painting our churches with these big images of Jesus that sort of look like the emperor, you know, all serious and strong and mighty, the belief of the people is going to be, wait a minute, is that how Jesus is? Sort of like this judge sitting up on a throne, waiting to be able to tell me which side I go in? What is that going to mean for the images of Mary that we see? Right? They say if you can't get in the door with Jesus, right, maybe Mary will open up a window for you, right? And that's sort of, you know, when you get the strong masculine image of God, what's the reaction to that? Every action has an equal and opposite reaction. We go toward, we look for other feminine images of God, which is what we see in Mary. Wow. Two different Christologies. We talk about two Christologies. High Christology is believing that Jesus is God. A low Christology is when we believe that Jesus is more human, like us. What is your Christology? The Arians had a very different Christology from other Christians.